Hello and welcome to the 81 All Out podcast. Like many of you listening, I'm deeply saddened by the tragic events that are unfolding in India. Some of my closest friends have been directly affected by the coronavirus, either because they have tested positive and they are recovering, or because they are grieving after the loss of their loved ones. We at 81 All Out have been discussing how we can show our solidarity for what is happening and how we can contribute. So we have decided that all the funds that we receive for the support of our show, we have decided that over the months of May and June, it will be donated to UNICEF, which is currently raising funds for the fight against COVID in India. They are delivering vital supplies and they are providing valuable support on the ground. For our part, we have decided to match your contributions for up to $800 US. And we hope that will be a small contribution in this big fight against this virus. So please follow the link in the show notes, as you usually do. We understand that you can donate to any organizations that you wish in your own capacity. But in this case, we too will be matching that amount till a certain cap. And for whatever you donate in May and June, we'll go towards that. And we will also be contributing.
In the air, Srijan takes it. India win.
He'll come back for the second. India have won the test match. India have won the series.
They're going to get back for two. India at home. Lords goes wild.
Hello and welcome to the latest episode of the 81 All Out podcast. This is your host, Siddhartha Vaidyanathan. And today I'm happy to be joined by two guests to talk about a series and a set of series from long, long time ago. It's been 50 years since India won their first ever series in West Indies and in England, both in the year 1971. And to mark this occasion, we have there's been a lovely little book that's been published. It's been authored by the sports writer and anchor Nishad Pai Vaidya, who is now also on the show. Thanks for joining, Nishad. Happy to have you here.
Hi, Sid. Thank you so much for having me. Been following your podcast for some time, so finally it's great to be on it and discuss about 1971, which we know that their contribution, that team's contribution has been immense in Indian cricket.
Absolutely, yeah. So Nishad's book is called Twice Upon a Time, India's Fairy Tale Cricket Victories of 1971. And it's a collection of anecdotes from one of the most important years in Indian cricket. And, many of I was not born at that time, and many of you listening might not know much about this series, but it is extremely vital in the progression of Indian cricket. So please pick up the book. And also joining us is my good friend and group sports editor of Midday, Clayton Murzello. Hello, Clayton.
Hi, Sid. Good to be here again.
Yes, again. Clayton has been on this podcast on two previous occasions. And many of you would have thoroughly enjoyed his stories about his career in cricket journalism. No exaggeration here, but when it comes to cricket and anecdotes, Clayton is quite a king. So I thought that if you're doing a podcast about anecdotes and Indian cricket, he should be here. So thank you. Thank you, Clayton.
Thank you, Sid. Thank you. Humbled.
Yes. So let's start. Let's set the stage a bit about 1971. It was when I was reading Nishad's book, it struck me. He mentions there how it was just 24. I mean, it was just very early since independence. It was hardly like 24 years after that. India was a young country. Indian cricket was still in the phase of maturation. If both of you can just talk about that time, it's so unrecognizable from today, isn't it?
Yes, it is, isn't it? And it's something like we really cannot associate with because we haven't seen those times. Like my generation, we grew up watching from a cricketing sense, a Sachin Tendulkar, then came an MS Dhoni, and that generation with Rahul Dravid, Saurav Ganguly and all of them. And also on an international stage, we saw an India that was getting, that had started welcoming the world into the country with its economic policies, liberalizing and opening up to the world. And we had seen a newfound confidence in the 90s and the 2000s. So it was a very, very different feeling. But then I must tell you this story because writing this book has also got a lot to do with my father, because everything about cricket came from my dad and, you know, his brothers and all of them. And obviously they used to talk about 1983 and how my dad was a young man at the time and, you know, what that victory did to inspire all of them. But I still remember my dad telling me that, you know, there was this series in 1971 and we had gone to the West Indies and England and we won in we won over there. And my dad said I was a teenager and I remembered all the scorecards by heart. He said it was like the 5 tests in the West Indies and the 3 tests in England. And he also, then one day on Star Sports, I think they were showing some old highlights and I saw Sunil Gavaskar batting, and I think it was the Manchester test, just the highlights, and then followed by the Oval test. And I asked my dad, what's this about? And then he told me, this is the series I was talking to you about where I was a teenager and I could remember everything. And, you know, also then you start correlating it with the other aspects of what was happening around politics at the time. 24 years, India still trying to find its feet on the world stage, already has faced 3 wars, 2 against Pakistan, 1 just after independence and 1 against China, and then 1 again in 65. And in 71, you've got this lady at the helm in India who takes a very firm stand in the eye of different powers and says that I'm not going to budge, and takes a very, very strong stand in the whole Bangladesh freedom movement and their struggle against Pakistan and what India as a country situated between the two of them had to do. So in that context, it really is different, because India as a nation wanted to find its own identity and confidence on the world stage. And in many ways, I have this belief that what a society is, you often see it in sporting success. And I think that was what was mirrored right through in cricket for India, right through its history. You see how society has evolved, how India as a country has evolved. You see the same thing in the cricketing sense. And I think 71 is the starting point of India's better phase, if I can use the word.
Yeah, fantastic. And Clayton, as somebody who, you know, grew up in Bombay through, you know, the 70s and 80s, 71 must have cast a large shadow on you, especially when talking to people. I mean, 71 was, of course, the big entry of Sunil Gavaskar, and that would have been also such a big shadow. So talk a bit about that, what it meant, what 71 meant to you when you were growing up.
It meant a lot, really, Sid, ever since I started reading Sunny Days. And that is what actually, you know, captivated me about that series. Without Sunil Gavaskar's book, Sunny Days, I know Ajit Wadekar wrote a book too, and Nishad always says that that is a great source of information for him. But I was captivated in a sense due to Sunny Days. The stuff I read in Sunny Days about, you know, how Gavaskar had that injury, he missed the first test match. Then Jayantilal playing the only test of his career. That was, you know, really fascinating for me. And that is how my interest about 71 began. And over the years, I started looking for more stuff. And I got more stuff. Got to know the players fairly well, fortunately. So it's been a great part of my cricketing upbringing, if you can call it.
Yeah, absolutely. And one of the things, again, when you're talking about sources and books, one of the things about Nishad's book is that there are these, you know, wonderful footnotes that leads to great sources as well. And, you know, I didn't even realize that so many of these players had spoken so well about the book. And you find, you know, he has found sources in Sports Week and all these other autobiographies and things. So, Nishad, talk a bit about the researching of that as well. I mean, that must have been quite a thrill in its own way.
Oh, it was. And I remember when I started in December, and a lot of the credit should also go to Clayton sir here, because he gave me those copies of Sports Week and the books by Sundar Rajan, the book by Wadekar and, you know, Prasanna, Jai Simha, all of them. So that definitely made it a lot easier. But when I started, from my memory and from whatever I had read over the years, I could only list down about 25 anecdotes. And yes, Clayton sir and my co-author and publisher, Mr. Sachin Bajaj, they said that don't worry about the number, just go ahead and do it. But deep down, we wanted to hit the magical figure, which was 71 anecdotes. So it's actually 71 anecdotes to mark 1971. And as I went through those books, and I could pick out quite a few other details. So that was really amazing. And what I did was, as India was winning the series in Australia, I spent my time only reading those books and sports weeks. So when the matches were going on and when Rishabh Pant and Pujara were up to their best down under, I was sitting here in my room and reading those books. That's all I was doing. So it was possibly one of the most productive times of my life. And then I also realized, thanks to my experience in working with a website, I know how to use Google very well and how to use Google keywords and search words and everything. And I use that very well to find out different articles. Like, I think I found out about the elephant and that walked at the Oval.
Bella the elephant,
you know, even found an article that was devoted to her. It was there, I think, in The Guardian. Then there were other interviews that I found out. I could find out great interviews by Wadekar, could tally a lot of the articles. Then there was one big story that was a part of the anecdotes, which in retrospect, I found out it was actually a myth and it never happened, because I read the scorecards and you could see that it never fit in anywhere. Then, as luck would have it, by the end of February, I actually had around 80 anecdotes. Then it was about merging some of them and cutting out some of them and getting it down to 71. So Sunny Days was a good source in terms of being a guideline, but you could also say that Ajit Wadekar's book is definitely one of the underrated aspects of Indian cricket, because that book, if you actually look back, it's a treasure trove of what's happened in 1971. So it was really exciting, and you know, it really puts into perspective the kind of struggle that those guys went through, because today, my generation especially, we have possibly taken it for granted. Look, we grew up watching Sachin Tendulkar at his best, you know, wearing a helmet and taking on the best, no doubt. And then as we grew older, we had the IPL and Indian cricket showing a lot of power and confidence. Back then, it wasn't like that. I mean, when India won in the West Indies, they were still trying to convince England that, look, you come for a reciprocal tour in end of 1971. And it wasn't an easy task for the BCCI. England was saying that we will not play these many side games. We want a smaller tour because we have got an Ashes coming up. We've got a home series against you and Pakistan. And then to come and tour the subcontinent and then play an Ashes at home, it's going to be a lot. But today, you tell any board that, you know, why don't you come to India? And they will just jump at the opportunity.
Yeah, now the situation is exactly the reverse.
Exactly.
In fact, India is the one who's saying that we will not play in this country. We will not play in that country.
So it was fascinating to find out such details. And you had read about it because of my journey in the cricket industry. But people who know about Indian cricket vaguely or who are hardcore fans at this time, they will possibly not know of such things. So it was very interesting to know. And I will again get this story on board, because I remember talking to Mr. Chandu Borde and him telling me, this was in one of the interviews I did earlier, where they would actually put, you know, sometimes they would put old gloves or they would put towels around their thighs when they faced the West Indies and their pace, because they didn't have thigh pads. And then this generation of 1971 had come just after that. And they still didn't have the best of facilities, yet they made the best of everything. So in that sense, it's really fascinating that these men actually went and did what they had to. Yes, there are a lot of people who say that Wadekar was lucky, but you know, what the hell? They ultimately went and they won the series and capitalized on the opportunity. West Indies may not have been at their strongest, but still you needed someone to go and do the job, and they did it for you.
Absolutely. I mean, Clayton, often these days, you know, it's very easy to look at averages and look at the number of matches that players played from the past and say that, how can you even compare them to the modern players, but people forget the realities of the time, right? Even to play international cricket then and to face up to many of the fast bowlers, that itself was something compared to now.
Yeah, I don't believe in all that talk that West Indies were, you know, not the great side they used to be. They were on the wane. Yes, they had a bad series in Australia in 68-69. But still, they had their fast bowling. They still had their home conditions. They still had their crowds to back them. We must not forget that. So, West Indies was a pretty formidable lineup back then. And about Wadekar, you know, Nishad said that, you know, some pundits say that he was lucky along. But to get that group together in his own way, you know, he was not a very demonstrative captain, but he was a great man manager. And it showed even in later in his career when he, you know, managed the Indian team. So, I don't think it's fair to say, you know, that Wadekar was a lucky captain. But he did best with his resources.
Yeah, and even if you, I mean, despite everything, you know, after 71, India next won in West Indies in 2006. So, even during the decline of the West Indies through the late 90s and 2000s, India never won there whenever they went. So, it's hardly something that you can brush aside.
Yeah, and Sid, we must never forget that, you know, previous to 1971, our last tour to the West Indies, we ended up losing 0-5.
Oh, yes, 62. Yeah.
Yeah, 62. What a bad series that was.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, and it also shows that, you know, India went to West Indies in 62 and then they went in 71, which means that almost no player, probably Jaisimha, but I'm not sure, but very, very few commonalities, right?
Sardesai, Jaisimha, Prasanna.
And yeah. Durrani. And Durrani as well.
And Durrani, yes.
And Durrani. That's it. But yeah. I'm saying, look at that's it. The rest were all new to the conditions. So it's not like now when, you know, Sachin went in 97 and whatever, 2002, et cetera, et cetera. So there were so many times, right?
That yeah. And even the hero of the tour, Gavaskar, he came into the side on the basis of university performances. If you look up, you know, he played, I think, only 4 Ranji Trophy games before making his first tour, international tour.
So, yeah, talk a bit about that, Clayton. That's actually a topic I wanted to bring up. And given that you have brought it up, talk a bit about, you know, what people knew about Gavaskar before he went to West Indies in 71. I'm assuming people outside Mumbai probably didn't know much about him at all. And even people in Bombay, they probably required like the hardcore journalists and the hardcore fans to actually have heard about him.
Yes, exactly. Because he scored a mountain full of runs in university cricket. And Vijay Merchant was aware of that. And all credit to Vijay Merchant. He backed Gavaskar for that tour. Yes, he may have got feedback from people who, you know, followed the university beat and things like that. But he backed a player who had not fared very well in Ranji Trophy or in first class cricket.
Yeah, wasn't he even dropped at one point from Ranji Trophy?
Yes, in his debut season, which he felt very bad about.
Which must have been what, 68 or 66?
68, I think, yes.
68. Yeah. Yeah. So and, imagine.
And even Gavaskar, you know, if you read Sunny Days, he talks about going to the board office to find out whether the team was declared. And then I think he went for a movie to kill time. And then he came back home. Without the news of the selection. And in the train was Saeed Hatia, who and the passengers in the train were, you know, talking about Gavaskar. But Gavaskar said he is a certainty. He will be picked. And that very emotional story, one of the best stories I've ever heard. You know, Gavaskar telling Hatia that I will call you when the team is announced. Hatia stayed in Bandra. Gavaskar got off at Dadar. And when the team was announced, Gavaskar says that, you know, he did not have the heart to call Saeed Hatia. I found that a very fascinating story. And to my good fortune, I ended up meeting Saeed Hatia on one of his tours to Mumbai. And that was a very satisfying interview to do because I had followed this story. I was always fascinated by this story in my childhood. And then I finally got to meet Saeed Hatia. And Fantastic. What a lovely interview he gave me.
Yeah, and Syed Hatia is a very interesting, you know, character, because even he lived, I think, eventually lived in England, but he used to come to Mumbai and play. And yes. Also, Nishad mentions him in a very touching anecdote in his book, where when India wins at the Oval, Syed Hatia is actually there at the ground.
Yes, Syed Hatia told me that he had gone to the Oval.
Ah, yeah.
Yes, he had. And yeah. In fact, thanks to Clayton, sir, I could actually get in touch with Syed Hatia, and he spoke to me for quite a while and narrated his whole story, which is what I added. And it's a very interesting quote that he adds, that back in the day, if you had to have a career in cricket, you either had to be employed by the Nirlons or the Asian Paints or, you know, ACC, yes.
ACC.
And the other companies, or you had to be royalty. And he said, I was neither. So, and he already had a family in the UK. So he had to go back and start working, get a job, which he worked with Marks and Spencer, actually. And there is an interesting anecdote that he told me is that when India won, he was in the grass banks and he felt that, you know, I could have been there, but he was really proud and happy of what they had achieved. And he couldn't come back to India again to play or to resume his career. And interestingly, ahead of the 1975 World Cup, the selectors had actually asked him to come down for a trial run, because they were trying to get a team together for the One Day World Cup, and they felt he could be useful. He was still playing cricket. He went on. He did play cricket even after that, but they called him for a trial run. He did quite okay in those trial matches, but then he didn't get the call. So he went back and he continued with his life in the UK. And it was quite fascinating that, you know, somehow, if some way, you know, things had worked differently, who knows, he could have been a part of that side.
So Hatia was a fast bowler, was he?
He was a fast bowler, and he impressed one and all in the Dilip Trophy in the 1970-71 series. And where I talk about all those selection dramas happening in the background with a cloud over the captaincy of M.A.K. Pathaudi. And you had a young fast bowler who was making quite a mark. He had just played, I think, one season for Bombay. And he incidentally dismissed Pathaudi with a beautiful delivery at the Brabourne Stadium. And it was, I think, the West Zone captain was Chandu Borde, and he was encouraging this young man. And he got Pathaudi with one that came in, and it was one with pace. And Jayantilal got 100 in that game. It was South Zone versus West Zone. And Jayantilal's 100 won him selection into the tour to the West Indies. And it was because the selectors saw that here was an opening batsman who could tackle fast bowling. And Hatia was really quick at the time. And Jayantilal told me that there was a time where almost every other ball was a short ball and it was quick. And he could pick it early and was hitting it in front of square and with a lot of control. So that tells you that he was seeing it early, and that gave the selectors a lot of confidence that here was an opener that they could back for selection. And there's a lot of interesting things happening around at the time, because I think even Clayton, sir, you've done a story, right, on the selection shenanigans, if I may use the word, as I did in the book.
Yeah, the most, the most significant story for me and the more interesting and the gripping story was Daljeet Singh. And
absolutely, yeah.
You know, Daljeet Singh came over to Mumbai with the Punjab team in 94-95 for the final. And I was really struck by his personality because, after every day's play, I used to go to Daljeet Singh and get a few quotes from the Punjab camp. And I encountered a very positive human being. And, he became a good friend of mine. And then one of those days, he said, I want to tell you something about myself, which you may not know. And he said, I would have been in that West Indies squad in 1971. And he told me his story. There was a Dulip Trophy game in Bombay. And the selectors were watching. Daljeet Singh says that he was a certainty to go on that tour as the wicketkeeper. One day before, as Venkat and Ramesh Saxena went out to toss, Ramesh Saxena was told to go and meet Vijay Merchant. And Saxena said, but I'm going out to the toss. So that the person who relayed that message said, no, stop the toss. go and meet Vijay Merchant. When he went up, Vijay Merchant told him that Gigi Boy will keep wickets for this game. We have seen Daljeet. There is no problem. We just want to see how Gigi Boy fares and how Gigi Boy is as a wicketkeeper. And let Daljeet play as a batsman. And it so happened that Gigi Boy kept wicket in that game. And then he got picked for the West Indies. And Daljeet was not considered at all. So Daljeet Singh feels very strongly about this. And, you know, he really felt that he was a certainty. And yeah, that's how Gigi Boy went on that tour.
Yeah, this is amazing how Daljeet Singh, despite having suffered that disappointment, Daljeet Singh went on to become the renowned curator and
unfortunately, he's known only as a curator, but he was a class first class player himself.
Exactly, but even when we used to meet him as a curator, yes. He had such a vibrant and buoyant personality. You would never
fantastic,
imagine him
yeah.
to have suffered such a raw deal and moved on with it so cheerfully. It strikes me how, you know, the more than the squad of players who played itself, the ones who just missed out or the ones who played one game or two games, the stories are so much more, you know, poignant. I mean, Jayantilal, his name has come up. I mean, he could have been the Indian opener through that whole series. You know, it was just a quirk of fate that allowed Gavaskar to play. And even he played through injury, of course. But who knows, Jayantilal could have had a great series too.
And Jayantilal had quite a good record on that West Indies tour in the first class matches. He got 100 against Guyana as well. And after the Guyana 100, even Rohan Kanhai felt that, you know, Jayantilal could go on to play the test match, but he didn't. The Indian team continued to back Ashok Mankad at the top. And it's fascinating because Jayantilal was on 5 in the first test and the outside edge flew across to Gary Sobers in the slips. Obviously, Sir Gary, being one of the greatest players of all time, took a blinder considering those times, you know, diving across and taking a catch. And then in the next test match, when Sunil Gavaskar was batting early in his innings, he had just 1-2 Gary Sobers and Sobers drops the simplest of catches. Jayantilal's career ended because of a blinder and Gavaskar edges one early in his innings and he drops one of the simplest of catches. And it's really interesting that, you know, how fate can play a role in someone's career. And
absolutely.
And another story is about Krishnamurthy, the wicketkeeper who kept in all the 5 tests in West Indies. You know, talking about Merchant telling Ramesh Saxena that you've got to play, we've wanted to see
Gigi Boy.
The similar instruction was passed on to the South Zone team that play Syed Kirmani as a wicketkeeper instead of Krishnamurthy. And Gopinath, who was the selector, told Maan Singh, who was the manager of the team. And Maan Singh, who was also later the manager of the 1983 World Cup winning team. He's like, nothing doing. You play the best wicketkeeper that is available to you. And that is Krishnamurthy today. So the South Zone selector actually played his part and said that we are not going to follow this. We are going to play the best wicketkeeper who's available for this match. And that's how Krishnamurthy played that game and went on to tour the West Indies and England. And even Kirmani did later in England. And he was a young man and had a great career with India. But again, it tells you that how one selector actually said, no, we're going to play the best keeper that's available for us.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know, that Duleep Trophy game, that Duleep Trophy final impacted so many people actually. There was Govind Raj who was picked because he got 5 wickets in the first innings. Then there was Gigi Boy, of course. And Jaisimha got 100 in that game. So
Daljeet Singh was also impacted because he didn't play that game. Nah?
Correct. Yes.
I think.
But if you look up the scoreboard, there's a plus mark against Daljeet Singh to indicate that he kept wickets. But it was Gigi Boy who kept wickets.
Oh, wow. So there is a bit of a scorecard mystery there as well.
Yes, yes. But it was the Gigi Boy definitely who kept wickets in that game.
Oh, but that's interesting. Somebody just seeing the scorecard may not even know this whole thing.
Yeah, and he just took one catch in that game. Huh?
Who, Gigi Boy?
Gigi Boy, yes.
But he still made it. But he didn't play, no? He didn't play in the West Indies.
Didn't play. He did not play for India. He played the side games.
Wow. So, interesting. Yeah. Neither Daljeet nor Gigi Boy played international cricket.
Yeah.
Okay, interesting, interesting. So, but talking about selection, the one thing that we can't miss out is, you know, Vijay Merchant. I mean, he almost seems to have cast such a big shadow over Indian cricket at that time. And it was like he could wake up and make a decision and that would be it, wasn't it? He was so big, is what I'm saying. Yeah.
No, imagine stopping a captain while going out to toss. I mean, you know, that's an indication of what how much power he wielded in those days. Yeah,
absolutely.
Yes, and also considering the fact that he was someone who wanted to axe Pathaudi. And again, we have to look at the society in those days. Pathaudi was still royalty. I think the privy purses were still on. I think they actually cancelled in 1971 itself. Or
70. Later on, yeah.
Yeah. So he was still a prince. He was still, India still had those hangovers of, you know, coming from just post-independence and Pathaudi, someone who's royalty. But then he still, Merchant still was very strong-willed enough to go ahead with that move. And although there were a lot of suggestions that Merchant was possibly a little unhappy about the fact that Pathaudi's father had beaten him in the race to captaincy in 1946, there are all those theories in the background. We don't know whether it's true or not true. But then you had, although again, another myth, the fact that the West Indies, the team that went to the West Indies was full of youngsters, and that Merchant was, of course, he was big on his policy of youngsters, but it also had a lot of experienced players. It had Jaisimha, it had Durrani, it had Bedi, it had Sardesai, it had Prasanna, it had a lot of players who had made their India debuts before Wadekar. So Wadekar as a captain also was, in the beginning, overawed with the responsibility that he's leading a team which has a lot of players who played for India before him and definitely has a lot of players who have come after him. So he again was in the middle and he had to strike a balance. So it wasn't the easiest team to lead if you see from that perspective.
Yeah. I remember Wadekar fought like hell for Sardesai. Because Merchant was not a great fan of Sardesai. In fact, it was Merchant who dropped Sardesai in that 69-70 home series. And I remember, you know, meeting Sardesai for an interview very, very long ago, about 30 years ago. One of my first interviews done for a Marathi magazine called Shatkar. And I asked him about his biggest disappointment. And he said, you know, being dropped in 1969-70 in the home series, thanks to Vijay Merchant. So I was not writing that down. And Sardesai, over his cup of coffee, said, write it. Thanks to Vijay Merchant.
And that 69 home season when India hosted Australia and New Zealand.
Yes.
Eight new players made their debut for India.
Yeah. Some of them didn't play again.
Yes, some of them didn't play again. And it was again that he was getting in players and they were going out. So it was, there was a lot of chopping and changing in those two series.
Yeah.
And also, one thing though about Wadekar, you know, you're talking about Pathaudi and Wadekar, and Pathaudi being such a big, you know, force at that time with as a prince and as a player and as a captain. He had also won in New Zealand in 67. So that was also a big deal.
Yes, we should never forget that.
Yes, we shouldn't. Yeah. I mean, that was India's
because
first
people's, ever. People still feel that, you know, the triumph in West Indies and England were the first overseas wins. No, we won in. And we won handsomely in New Zealand.
3-1.
Yes.
3-1, which is a huge deal in New Zealand. In any,
yeah, in
any
New Zealand time, conditions.
In New Zealand conditions. But talk a bit about, you know, Wadekar at that time and his stature. I mean, Wadekar, of course, was a giant for Bombay in domestic cricket. But, you know, for India as a batsman, even at that time, I don't think he would have been the best batsman in the team. But there was something about his captaincy that must have caught Merchant's eye, wasn't it, Clayton?
Yeah, because also you should remember that Merchant was chief selector for Mumbai. So he saw a lot of Wadekar, the captaincy side of Wadekar for Bombay. So, you know, I think that may have prompted him to do what he did.
Yeah, and also, you know, reading the book, it comes across as two things. One, of course, Wadekar is somebody who, you know, loved to be in the middle of the challenge. You know, whether it was facing the West fast bowlers in West Indies, Uttan Doe, or taking on John Snow in England. I mean, he wanted to be there. And even if when he got injured, he wanted to guts it out. And second thing was he had this sort of certain innovative methods of captaincy where he was close to Gavaskar and Solkar, and then he used to purposely, get after them and say, why did you come late for the meeting? Even though they didn't come late for the meeting, because he wanted to pass on the message to the others.
Yeah, tremendous ways of getting the job done.
Yeah, exactly. Man management skills at its peak, I must say.
Yeah, it was. And that and why he did that, he, again, as I said earlier, he had players who had played for India before him, and he couldn't actually tell them or reprimand them if they were late. So Gavaskar and Solkar being juniors, they would come to the team meeting 5 minutes earlier. He would ask one of them, you go, and then come back after 5 or 10 minutes. And then the team had assembled, and when they would come, he would say, why are you late? This is not done. You have to be on time. So apparently once Gavaskar was not happy and he was close to Wadekar, he's like, why are you doing this? You know, I've come 5 minutes earlier and then you ask me to go on your instruction. I come later. And then he's like, no, you don't understand. I can tell you things. I cannot tell them. Now this will instill some discipline in the team.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I think Clayton, Gavaskar also did that, right? When he was captain.
I don't remember. He may have.
Yeah. I think he may have as well. I think he has spoken about it. But yeah, I mean, a bit about, Wadekar, the batsman. I mean, I don't think he gets his due as an international batsman. Of course, everyone agrees that he was a colossus for Bombay cricket. But, Wadekar as a batsman had this ability to make that crucial contribution, whether it was in West Indies or England or even, I think, New Zealand. When India won for the first time, he made some really crucial contributions there.
Well, he got his one and only 100 in New Zealand.
Yeah, exactly. So,
yes, and you look at what you don't go by the pure numbers.
Yeah.
Look at what he signified for India in the West Indies when they were facing Yuton Do in the first game at Jamaica. One ball climbed and it hit him on his hand, and a blood vessel tore in his hand. But he was like, no, I cannot walk out now, even if I'm bleeding. And he didn't look at his glove. He's like, because if I look at my glove, I'll feel demoralized. So he continued batting because he wanted to show the team that they can actually take on these bowlers, even if they weren't of the same stature or pace as a Wes Hall or a Charlie Griffith. Another myth that I've written in my book about is that Charlie Griffith didn't feature in any of the test matches in 1962. He only played that game for Barbados where he felt nari contractor, but the impact was so huge that people feel that Charlie Griffith bullied India throughout that series, but he didn't. It was that one game. And Wes Hall was the one who played that whole series. So coming back to 70-71, where Wadekar had to set the tone, and he did. He batted for 4 hours, scored 70, had a crucial partnership with Sardesai in that first in India's first outing. Fast forward to Lords, and John Snow, who had felled Terry Jenner at Sydney earlier in the year, had taken a bag full of wickets against the Aussies in Australia to win the Ashes. And here he is bowling at the home of cricket, and Wadekar takes him on from ball one. Snowball shot, he's hooking him for fours. So that tells you that here was a captain who wanted to set the tone. Now I will bring in a number. When Wadekar was dismissed in the first test, India was on 125 and Wadekar had scored 85 out of those 125. Imagine in those days. And that is something you will associate with someone like a Sehwag in modern days. Like when Virendra Sehwag used to get going, he would get 85 out of India's first 130 or 140 runs. But Wadekar did it back in 1971.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's a fantastic
That's a great find, Nishad. Congrats.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, and then the thing is that, it is not that much memorialized as it should be, because that was the innings. You play such an innings in the first test match of a series, that takes something to do.
Yeah. When you spoke to Wadekar much later, and he was not the one who could bring up his own performances and things like that. There was so much that we know about Wadekar, but there is so much that we don't know also about Wadekar.
Yeah. Absolutely.
Yeah, he was never one to, express himself and, blow his own trumpet, which was needed at some times.
And also, Clayton, you, of course, will remember this very well. In 2007, when India won the series in England, after winning at Trent Bridge and drawing at the Oval, Ajit yes. Wadekar, captain of the Indian team in 71 to win their first ever series in England, tells yes. Clayton Morzello that this series victory is greater than the Oval.
Imagine that was quite stunning.
Yes, which other? Yeah,
I remember we went to the back of the pavilion to speak to him, Siddharth.
Absolutely, and we went to the back of the pavilion. This was just before the press conference, and you asked him for a reaction, and he says greater than 71. And oh yeah. my goodness, wow. I don't think any other Indian captain would have even said anything remotely close to that, because for him it was his greatest achievement. But he is
sorry to interrupt you. And what made it so special was that Wadekar is telling us this at the Oval.
Yes, correct.
Yeah.
So it just tells you the graciousness of the man, and also the fact that he did not want to, you know, live in his own zamana. He was willing to concede that the youngsters have done well. And it was a very revealing moment for me, and I'm sure for you as well.
The modern day players, you know, have so much of a glamorous lifestyle, and, you know, the viewing, how they are viewed and things like that. But, you know, if you ask me, one of my favorite memories of 1971 and London, we're talking about the England part of the tour, is that after the 2002 Test match, India versus England Test match, there were members of that 1971 team in England for the Wisden Cricketer of the Century, Indian Cricketer of the Century.
Ha, ha.
And my favorite moment of that 2002 tour was, yes, the NatWest Trophy win. But my favorite moment was also going, you know, walking towards the tube station and seeing Ashok Mankad, Ajit Wadekar and Eknath Solkar walking together ahead of me to the tube station. And, you know, 1971 just came rushing back to me in that wow. very walk.
Wow. Yeah.
And, you know, I felt I was such a fortunate individual. To see these three great players walking in front of me, that those 1971 heroes.
My similar memory was during yes. the 2017 Champions Trophy and at the Oval Tube Station again. And we took the tube. I sit in the tube and I realize Clive Lloyd is sitting next to me.
Oh, wow. that would have been hard to miss anyway.
Yeah. No, but he was so... I realized these men were talking cricket and he was with Ovesh Shah and Steve Harmison. I think they were doing commentary. And I used to pick up the Evening Standard and just go and I used to read. So I wasn't exactly aware of what's happening around me because I'm in my papers. And then I go, I sit and I'm like, okay, these men are talking. And I'm like, oh, it's Clive Lloyd.
Well, now that both of you have brought up the Oval and the Tube, you know, my memory is going back to that, you know, getting out of that Kennington station and you see all those bowling actions on the walls of the Tube station. And I think Ray Lindwall's action is there right at the end when you get off and you get up the stairs, you see Ray Lindwall's action. And that's just poetry. I mean, Lindwall bowling there and then you're going to the cricket. It's just a romance of cricket.
Right, I remember that, Siddha, and I remember shooting some pictures also.
Yeah, and I think that, both of us wrote diary items about that as well. Yeah, that was amazing. Yeah,
but I must say on this podcast that, you know, Sid and me shared a room during that tour. And it was fascinating because every night we used to come back from the cricket and think about the stories the next day. And we had you know, coined, you know, ratings for our stories. And a good story was a 4. A great story was a 6. A mediocre, fine, you know, chalta-ish story was a 2. So, you know, before we went to bed every night, we said we should tell each other, tomorrow we have to hit a 4.
Yeah. That was 2007 was amazing. I will never forget it. And there were times in which, you know, we would, there was one day in which Clayton, thanks to Clayton, I also got to sit in with an interview with Ian Chappell. And of course, Ian Chappell being the great...
No, Siddharth, we had planned that interview together. So you should take credit yourself.
Oh, sorry. Okay.
It was about 30 years in broadcasting.
30 years in broadcasting. Correct. And yeah, I will link that interview. It is a remarkable interview. Of course, Ian Chappell doesn't need any prompting. I mean, Ian Chappell is Ian Chappell. He will talk great stories. But I remember after that interview, immediately, both of us immediately knew, okay, this is a six. We have hit a six. This was such a good interview.
And Sid, what was special about that interview for me was when I was a child, I saw a picture of Ian Chappell, Greg Chappell, and Rod Marsh discussing the playing 11 for the test match, the 1975 Lord's Ashes test match. And Ian Chappell is sitting on the same bench, the same kind of bench we sat on and interviewed him in 2007.
Wow.
That was a very, very emotional moment for me. That it was not the same bench, yes, but it was one of those benches where we sat down and interviewed Ian Chappell.
Wow. Yeah, this is that's brilliant. I mean, it says tells you about the connection that you can make with history, that cricketing history over the generations. And, it didn't strike me because I have not seen the photo. But Clayton, thank you for sharing this. And
I can share the picture.
That moment well. I remember that bench very well. So,
yes.
Yeah. But, coming back to 71, another player, of course, who, you know, was, I would say, the hero, one of the heroes of the tour. And has its own connection. I mean, Gavaskar was, of course, the newbie who was making it big and who was coming onto the stage and the future. But Dilip Sardesai, I mean, here is somebody who has played for so long. He gets this chance to come to West Indies and West Indies and England. And oh my God, what a remarkable two series for him. And what a jolly man he seems to come across. I mean, Clayton, you can maybe start. You knew him also.
Yeah, I mean, what a wonderful man. I always say this about Dilip Sardesai. When you called him for a reaction or for a comment on any subject, however controversial, however funny, however interesting, or however boring, Dilip Sardesai always gave you an answer. Never have I heard him say no comment. I told you about, how he attacked Vijay Merchant in that interview and told me, write it.
Yeah.
You know, he was that sort of a man. He will tell it as it is, you know. What a wonderful person. And again, never made a big fuss about, how many runs he scored in the West Indies and, how he was also one of the bigger heroes in that triumph. A wonderful person. And what a wonderful batsman he may have been.
Terrific. I mean, first test, Gavaskar doesn't play because of an injury. And you have Sardesai playing that vital knock. And then in that match that, not Trinidad, but I think Barbados match.
Barbados, the 10th test match.
Yes.
The 10th test match, the kind of contribution. I mean, Nishad, it must have been fascinating just researching him for the book.
True. And I must tell you this, that I'm from Goa originally. And growing up, I remember asking my dad, who's a Goan test cricketer? And the only answer he could give me was Dilip Sardesai. So because he's originally from Goa. Sure, there have been a couple of others who have their distant roots from Goa. But Sardesai is someone who is born and bred in Goa and he came to Mumbai and chased his dream. So for Goans, he's definitely a special figure. And the way he talks, that is a very Goan way. Like a lot of people in Goa are very straightforward. They don't mean harm. They don't mean anything. It's just that they are. Like, for example, when they were in Jamaica, and Sunil Gavaskar narrates this story of watching Grayson Shillingford bowling the ball and Van Burn Holder. And he says that the wicketkeeper is collecting it about chest height or just above his head. And they've not seen this in India. And after a couple of overs, the pavilion was square of the wicket at the old Sabina Park. And I obviously, I'm going to only give you the edited version of what he said. He's like, hey, kasle fast bowlers hai in Marathi, which means that what kind of fast bowlers are these? He was, of course, not as charitable. But Gavaskar says that instantly you've got this guy, a senior player, who talks about these guys. We as youngsters are looking at them and the wicketkeeper is collecting it somewhere else. And we feel that if these guys are fast, imagine what Charlie Griffith and Wes Hall were like back in 62. And that just gave them confidence that we can go and face these guys. And yeah. coming to the 150 he got at Barbados, which he rated as a better innings because it helped India out of... India had their backs to the wall again, like 70 or 80 odd for five, with West Indies having scored 500 plus, and he again has a partnership with Solkar. And there he tells Solkar that now that the West Indies have got a spinner on, we have a better chance of playing the spinner than the fast bowlers they have. Utondo made his debut in that game, by the way. So he says that, you know, let's act as if we cannot pick Inshaan Ali's googly so that Sobers actually goes on and, you know, keeps him, persists with him so that we've got an easier time. And this is an interview that he gave the Illustrated Weekly of India, which Sardesai says that, you know, it was very... Sobers may have been the greatest cricketer, but he wasn't the greatest captain, and you could fool him with such theatrics. But remember that if Sobers is the greatest captain, then I am the greatest fielder ever. So yeah, that tells you a lot about the man, that, you know, he had that kind of sense of humor. And Sobers, by the way, wasn't given out caught in the at bat pad, and Sardesai had taken that catch and they had appealed, and Durrani in a rare emotional outburst had even like shown his disgust at, you know, Sobers not being given out at Guyana, and Sobers got 100. So apparently Sardesai told Sobers that, you know, Gary, why didn't you walk? That was my first catch.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, but... talking about catches, you know, Bishan Bedi said this, I think, in the inaugural, not inaugural, the second Dilip Sardesai lecture. And Bedi said, you know, a lot of people ask me, what was the turning point of the Oval Test match in 1971? So I tell them, you know, the turning point of that Test match was when Sardesai went back to the dressing room, maybe because of an injury or something, and Jayantilal came in, and Jayantilal got rid of D'Oliveira. So that was the turning point of the 1971 Oval Test match.
Yes, that was a good catch, by the way, at mid-on.
Yes, yeah.
And again, the romance of Jayantilal taking that catch. Jayantilal, who, you know, played one test, was replaced by Gavaskar, and then yeah. didn't play after for India after that, comes as a substitute and takes the catch in the victory, the first ever victory in England. I mean, that is a story.
And Jayantilal's only, you know, regret, the way he expresses it, it's lovely. I mean, I don't think he'll want to go on the record with it, but the way he says, "Arey, mere ko liya nahi. Main itna run banaya, liya nahi."
Yeah, I mean,
that was a sad part of it. Yeah,
it's the what could have been, right? That's the ones that sticks by. And you spoke a bit about Govind Raj, but one thing I never knew about Govind Raj is that he settled down also, you know, abroad, that he didn't play for India. He didn't play cricket only after 73 or 74.
Yes. Yeah. And interestingly, he also married a West Indian girl during the 71.
Yes. Yes.
Not many know that. He married a West Indian girl. Then they went to England in 71. He tried talking to counties. It didn't work out. 74, he retired. And then he moved back to England to work for the State Bank of India.
Oh, yeah. Okay. Interesting. Oh, so he settled down in England.
He settled down in England, yes.
And he married. He was married to a West Indian girl at some point. Yeah.
He married a West Indian earlier.
Yeah, in 71. Okay, very interesting. Very interesting. So, the thing about Sardesai and that googly, I mean, you know, it is thinking about it itself is quite remarkable, because irrespective of the quality of the bowler, to act as if you're struggling against him and yet score is not an easy thing to do for anybody at any level of cricket. So Sardesai must have been quite a dada player to be able to achieve that level of proficiency against spin.
Yeah, and remember, Siddharth, I don't know whether, you know, 10 years would have a bearing on his mind. Only he could have answered this question. But the last test match he played before that Kingston innings was 1962, and he got a pair in that test match.
Hmm.
Sardesai. He played the Trinidad test match in the 1962 series. He got a pair in that test match. And it was that series where he was made to open the innings. And I remember him telling me, you know, because of Nari Contractor's injury, I was made to open the innings. And I said, look, I'm not an opening batsman. I'll do the job. but you must not drop me. You know, I mean, it took some guts to tell the team management that you shouldn't drop me if I fail.
Yeah, I think he had probably reached the stage of his career where he had little to lose. And so he said, okay, I'm just going to go for it, right? Yeah. So you're saying the last test match he played for India or the last test match he played against West Indies?
The last test match he played against West Indies. Before that Kingston innings.
Correct.
He bagged a pair in that test match.
Okay. Yeah.
He didn't have a very good series apart from maybe one half century.
That was the series where he probably opened with Vijay Mehra, right? The youngster.
Yes.
Young Vijay Mehra. Yeah.
Yeah, when Nari contractor got injured. Yeah.
Correct. Yeah, that was that. So, I mean, the other personality, of course, that comes to mind in that series, again, huge aura, larger than life figure. I mean, Salim Durrani, who Prasanna, in fact, I think the biggest compliment that Prasanna gave was there was this famous photo of Prasanna, Bedi, Chandra, Venkat and Durrani all together. And he said, you know, he pointed at Bedi, Chandra, Venkat and himself. And he said, we were spinners, but the genius is in the middle. And that was Durrani. So it told me the kind of respect that a man like Salim Durrani would have had in the Indian team. And of course, he didn't have any great performance, but still those two wickets to win India, to help India win that test match.
Yeah.
Nobody can forget that. Even today, Durrani's twin strikes are what people talk about, right? Yeah.
You know, that Trinidad test match was such a great team effort, actually. With guys chipping in like Durrani, and then Sardesai gets 100. Gavaskar gets those two half centuries, vital half centuries on debut. That test match is a fascinating test match.
It is. It definitely is. And, you know, talking about Durrani, people forget that on that 62 tour, he got 100 batting at number 3.
Yeah.
And again, after Nari contractor had got hit on the head, you know what the team, what the psyche would have been like. And then he goes, and remember at Trinidad in the first innings, Durrani didn't get to bowl. He actually told Jaisimha and Prasanna ki captain ko bolo mujhe bowling karne dene. And they did. And then Wadekar did say, okay, fine, you know, let's give him the ball. And as genius as he would be, he got Sobers with one that, you know, just went past him and bowled him. And then he moved the fielder, him and Wadekar decided to place Wadekar itself at midwicket, and Clive Lloyd plays the ball straight to midwicket. And then it's done. And you look at those figures, 17 overs. I think he conceded only 21 runs for those two wickets.
You're right. Yeah. With 8 maidens.
Yeah.
I've got the scorecard in front of me. That's how I know. I'm nothing by memory.
So it's really amazing that, you know, and another interesting thing about the Trinidad test match, Abid Ali became the first Indian bowler to take a wicket of the first ball of a test match. It was Roy Fredericks who was bowled of the first ball.
Wow. Yeah. And then Kapil did it later, right?
Kapil did it twice. Yes, twice.
Yeah, twice. Yeah.
And so, what about Venkat? Venkat 5 wickets in the second
half. Yes. Venkat 5 wickets. And even didn't... Jaisimha play that match?
Jaisimha didn't play that match. No,
Jaisimha had a part to play in Durrani bowling in the second innings.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. Yeah.
Correct. So, yeah, I mean, so many aspects of that test match. But I think Durrani didn't do too much after that, right? I mean, that was pretty much...
He was dropped for the England series and then he came back for the home series. I think in 72-3.
Durrani, I mean, we have to spend a little bit of time. I mean, even though it's not 71, but the fact that in the late 60s, and in the 60s, you had this guy who was such a huge superstar of Indian cricket. I mean, people used to actually go to games to watch Salim Durrani batting or Salim Durrani playing. And, you know, people used to shout for sixers and he used to give them the sixers. What a player he must have been.
He definitely was. And he still has that aura about him in spite of his age. And I remember interviewing him. It was one of my early interviews. And my boss had told me, you know, you have to interview him for his birthday. And this was, I think, 2012. So he was already in his late 70s, maybe. And he still had that aura over the phone. Like, I asked him, you know, do you feel maybe if you had played in the next generation, maybe you would have found success? And not even just the next generation, maybe now. T20, he's like, huh? T20 khelte, खेलते एंटरटेन करते मजा भी आता so he still had that approach that you know approach cricket with that kind of an aura and you know people talk about those twin strikes and talk to anyone who's played domestic cricket with him he had that ability to produce those magic moments like he would tell players that he would tell his teammates give me the ball now I will get this done and he could do that so he had that kind of an aura about him and he could do it but 29 tests over a period of 13 years doesn't do justice to the kind of ability that he had and definitely we also should remember that in 61-62 the home series that India won against England this yes. was the same series where Subhash Gupte was dropped for those infamous reasons and you yeah. still had a Salim Durrani filling in as a spinner and forming a good partnership with Chandu Borde and in the pages of history we often forget these contributions but it's important that we give them their due credit
Siddharth, yeah, I would like to go, you know, I would like to talk about what happened pre-tour. We shouldn't forget, you know, the camp at CCI, the Nets were supervised by Vijay Manjrekar before they left for the West Indies. And in the Films Division clip, you can see Manjrekar, you know, behind the stumps, supervising the Nets sessions. And also, Bishan Bedi once spoke about how Adhikari, gave a lot of catching practice to Sardesai and Durrani. So he used to take them in one corner and give them, you know, and Bedi imitates Adhikari very well by saying, Dilip Salim, Dilip Salim, Dilip Salim, while giving them catch practice.
Yeah, I mean, fielding played a huge role, right, through both the West Indies and England. And Adhikari yeah. was the manager in the England leg and yeah. KK Tarapore as well. I mean, even he seems to have had a role to play because the Indian team's kit did not come and he made sure that they had practice before the tour games and all that. Yeah.
And I think he was the guy who advised Gavaskar not to get his tooth extracted, isn't it?
Yes, he was the one.
Yeah.
He told him there's going to be, if that happens, there's going to be medicines, there's going to be all sorts of other things. There'll be pain, you'll be drowsy. So we cannot risk that in the middle of a test match.
This was before the final test in Trinidad.
Yes. Yeah. And it was only after Gavaskar was dismissed on the last day that he allowed him to go and get his tooth extracted.
And this was the test where Gavaskar got 200s.
Yes.
Yeah, I think Gavaskar was at the dentist when India won. To be verified. Yeah. I think Gavaskar was at the dentist while India drew that test match and then won the series.
Oh, this was a tooth pulling end of the game.
Yeah.
And the other cricketer, now that you mentioned Durrani, is whose contribution was immense across those two tours is Eknath Solkar.
Oh yes. First test match partnership with Sardesai, where Sardesai told him. Think that you're playing for Hindu Gymkhana, not for India.
Yeah. I mean, first
because
of
they
all,
used to play together for Hindu Gymkhana.
Okay. And Solkar comes across, I mean, you know, whether it's with his sledging or whether it's with his attitude, he comes across as this such a, you know, classic Mumbai product who is like, who will make sure that irrespective of his ability, of which was plenty, by the way, that he would always perform, always win. That kind of ability, no?
Yeah, real hard-nosed cricketer when it came to, you know, grit and determination.
Hmm.
I mean, typical Mumbai cricketer. Not that, you know, cricketers from other states are not full of grit and determination. That's very wrong to say. But Solkar had that. And also a well-humored man. Could take things lightly and stuff like that.
Yeah, I mean, he tells because Boycott was Boycott's girlfriend was older than him. He said, "Go." What did he say? Something about his auntie.
Go and tell your auntie. And again, it also tells you Wadekar as a captain looking after these two youngsters, Solkar and Gavaskar himself.
Gavaskar,
another story that I heard in one of the talks is that when Gundappa Vishwanath got dismissed for duck on test debut, Eknath Solkar was his roommate. And what happened was that I think Gundappa Vishwanath got out and he told him something like, you know, don't worry, there are a lot of players who got out for duck on their test debut, listed a few of them who went on to do great things, and at the end he says, and Eknath Solkar. so he had that kind of sense of humor. And also the other funny story was in the West Indies when in one of the tour games, the ball went sky high, Solkar was settling underneath it, and again the Caribbean crowd gets involved and someone says, you know, Solkar, you drop that catch and you can have my sister. And Eknath Solkar completes the catch, but Wadekar being Wadekar asks him, like in Marathi, which means, did you hear what they say? He's like, yeah, I heard, but I've not seen his sister. So I mean, the kind of presence of mind to come up with such lines, it really speaks volumes of someone like him.
And also, I mean, we talk about Gavaskar, you know, playing against fast bowling without helmets and all those cricketers playing without protection and without helmets. But to feel that short leg without protection against, you know, almost all day you're standing at short leg, and then to actually go closer to the batsman, that is, you know, truly some kind of courage in itself.
Yeah, not only was, yeah, you're right, Siddharth. Not only was, you know, he the best close-in fielder of his generation, if not all time, but he was also one of the bravest men to set foot on a cricket field, you see.
Yes.
You had to have some special guts to do that.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean,
Farooq Engineer, you know, once told me that at the end of the day, where we used to all, you know, we would look forward to our drink, whatever they were served up, there used to be Eknath Solkar at one end of the dressing room, you know, attending to his wounds for the day, while we were looking forward to our drinks.
Wow, that's amazing. That tells you so much. Yeah.
Yeah.
And crucial catches in both test wins in Trinidad and as well as the Oval.
Oval, yeah.
Yeah, just crucial catches. I mean, the way he would just die, like for one of those catches, he just threw himself forward and, you know, took it inches off the ground. And
yeah.
Alan Knott.
And even at Trinidad, he took those catches. All those catches in hindsight worth their weight in gold.
Yeah,
and I think the story about that Alan Knott catch is that Knott used to play that typical flick behind backward point, which and they, instead of plugging the gap, they left it vacant because Solkar said, I can dive and get that catch also. And he did eventually.
Oh, it's really amazing. And the kind of guts with the bat as well, getting that 50 at Kingston and getting the 50 in Barbados again in partnership with Sardesai.
Yeah. You know,
someone like him, like, would just never give up. And at 70 for 5 or 80 for 5, when you're up against 500, what kind of a situation are you looking at? And still to show that kind of character, it's simply unbelievable.
Yeah. So, yeah, I mean, we have spoken about so many of the players, but of course, let us we have to come back to the two heroes who are associated with those victories. I mean, one is, of course, Gavaskar. I mean, the quantum of runs that he scored in 1971, I mean, first of all, it's still mind-boggling. I mean, you would think that over time, you know, with all these records happening, you would think that, you know, those records are still not seen in that light. But you know, that is almost still the gold standard for Indian cricket. And I think that even now, if India plays like a 5-test series, or was this 5 or 6 tests? 5 tests, right?
5 tests.
Yeah, 5 tests. What are the odds of somebody scoring 700 plus runs? You know, I mean,
yeah, and the sequence, Siddharth, the sequence is amazing.
Yeah.
It really is. And imagine the last